yeah, if you're not having fun, find something else to do. For the Metroid short, some people are like, oh wow, it's a little too different. To me, that's fine because it's a fan film, and I think if you're gonna do a fan film, don't make it the way Hollywood would make it. Evenveil is a fantasy short that I had been thinking about for a long time that I really wanted to do. I really wanted to step up my game with green screen compositing, which I'd been doing for a long time.
I mean, I was shocked because it seems a very limiting space.
Our poor actors were spinning them around so much because we only had 90 degrees worth of green screen, maybe less than that. Your eye line is now over here. I always knew that I wanted to have my own company. Leaving my job was a huge decision. I was leaving a salary, I was leaving health insurance.
What happened on day one of rainfall?
That was a crazy day. We still have people angry at us. They'll send us like hate mail, like, you fooled me. I've never gotten over it. I'll never forgive you.
Hey, Sam.
Hello, Jamie. How are you?
I'm very good, thank you. How's things?
Things are good, you know, midweek. Things could go either way. We'll see.
Just want to say I appreciate your time today, Sam. I know you're a busy guy and you've got multiple projects on, so I just want to say thanks.
Oh, of course. Well, thanks very much for having me on.
Oh, pleasure. Absolute pleasure.
Hi, my name's Sam Balcomb. I'm a director, writer, and a visual effects producer, a co-owner of Rainfall Films that was started between me and several other friends back in 2008. So it was actually our 15-year anniversary this year, and I can't believe that we're still around. I've been interested in visual effects ever since I was a kid, watching Star Wars and getting the art of Star Wars books and watching the behind-the-scenes stuff and seeing how they did everything.
How do I get? Yes!
When I got into filmmaking, I knew that I was going to be doing projects that were probably going to have a lot of visual effects in them, or at least have them that be a component of them. And I knew that I couldn't afford to pay anyone to do this for me, so I decided to just kind of dive in and try to learn myself. Kind of dove into After Effects and Photoshop and Cinema 4D and any other programs I could get my hands on at the time, legally or not so.
We've all done it.
Yeah. That's fine. Very poor college kid. Yeah, in college, I actually tried to shoot a feature independent fantasy film. I was a little bit ambitious, but as it went, I managed to get a job in visual effects after college. Eventually, spent several years at post houses doing that until I felt comfortable enough or stupid enough to leave and start a company of my own. So here I am.
Was there a specific reason for stepping into that space where you start something of your own?
I always knew that I wanted to do that. Even, again, as a kid doing my home movies, I would have like a little production company name and I'd make a little title card to put up. So I always knew that I wanted to have my own company. Leaving my job was a huge decision. I was leaving a salary. I was leaving health insurance. We had no guarantee that we would get clients, that we would have ongoing business, any kind of success. We were lucky enough to, I think, hit things at the right time and have a combination of skill sets that made it work, because we didn't want to just do post or production. We wanted to be an all-in-one house where we could go take a project from development, pre-production, to shoot, to post, and final delivery. You know, when things started off, our primary business was music videos. And this was in, you know, the mid to late 2000s, when there were still budgets for that kind of thing. That industry just completely fell out. Record labels were not giving artists money anymore for that kind of stuff, unless you were like the top of the top. So we had to pivot. We had to figure out, okay, where can we go? What stuff can we do that isn't reliant on that? One of my other partners is an editorial. My other partner is all audio. So we were able to kind of go where the business was.
What happened on day one of Rainfall?
This is back in 2007. IGN, I went to them and I pitched them an idea of a feature that they could do, where they could take video games that haven't yet been made into movies and make fake trailers for them. And so we chose The Legend of Zelda, and they gave us free rein to go and shoot something, and we did. We had an absolute blast making it. At the time, we were very pleased with it, and IGN launched it on April 1st of 2008. As like, hey, there's a Zelda movie coming out, here's the trailer. We launched Rainfall Films the same day. Mostly a good idea, because it got our names in the trades, it really got our name out there. That was a crazy day one, we were watching the insane reaction and fallout from that video, that just got tens of millions of hits. We still have people angry at us to this day who will send us you know, email, like hate mail, like, you fooled me. I've never gotten over it. I'll never forgive you.
So unnecessary. And that I do not forgive.
Well, that leads on to the Metroid short. How did that come about? Was that another fan film that you approached somebody to, you know, we can make this?
For the Metroid short, we were developing a few things, some original ideas, some feature scripts. Ended up putting a poll online on our site and on social media saying, hey, if we did another fan film type project, what should we do? We kind of wanted to test the waters a little bit. One of the Metroid fan sites got wind of it, and so they would like send their forum users over to kind of brigade the voting booths. So that ended up winning, which is fine by me because I love those games. I love that world, and I hadn't done anything sci-fi in a while, so I thought this would be a really fun project. When it won, I was excited, but I was also really dreading it because I knew like our biggest hurdle was going to be the suit that Samus wears. It's so iconic and it moves in such a specific way. You know, you build this thing in real life and it's going to be cumbersome. It's going to be, you know, like a tank. We hadn't done anything with motion capture before. We started looking into it and we actually found some guys here in Burbank that did this thing called mobile mocap, where they came to us and it's literally just a computer and a jumpsuit with sensors built in. And it worked incredibly well. I was really surprised. You know, some cleanup was needed later, but all mocap really needs cleanup work. We ended up shooting the film that way, and it was going to be pretty much all CG except for when we kind of go inside.
Oh, the visor stuff.
I kind of wanted to do it in a bit of a retro style.
But you can definitely see that comes across, absolutely.
I was thinking about it for a while, and it wasn't really exciting me to approach it in a more modern way. When I was playing the first Metroid in the 80s, that first game was inspired by, you know, Alien, and it had that kind of analog feel to it. So let's kind of bring that into the film. When we put it out there, it did extremely well, and I was very, very happy and honored to have the response that it did. Some people are like, oh, wow, it's a little too different, too detached from Metroid for me. And to me, that's fine because it's a fan film. And I think if you're going to do a fan film, don't make it the way Hollywood would make it.
If you're already a part of our incredible community, thank you so much. And it really means the world to us. But if you're new here and you haven't hit that subscribe button, we would really appreciate it if you could just take a second to do so. In return, we promise to keep creating and bringing you bigger and better content. Now back to the episode. How do you sort of approach like the story? Do you go through the forums or do you just go with what you would like as a fan and a writer, director, you know?
I mainly go with what I would like as a fan. I didn't want to go too far away from it where it would disrespect the property. And I've seen some fan films that go extremely far with something to the point where the owners of the IP would consider it damaging. We didn't talk about it at all after that contest. And we said, okay, Metroid 1, we're going to make one. We're going to shut up now. You're not going to hear from us until it's done. That's just going to attract attention to it. And we want to just be able to get it out there and not Nintendo too much.
Were they fine with it when it did come out?
We didn't get any takedown notices. So that's
a good start.
That's as fine as it's going to get, which I'm okay with.
I guess talking about the actual process of the short, so particularly Metroid and Evenveil, when we get onto that one, where does it all start for you? What's your typical process?
Definitely starts with the story, with an idea. There has to be some kind of hook that makes it interesting. Like, why would I want to watch this? We did have a whole script. We did have a whole story that we ended up thrown in the trash because there wasn't anything surprising about it. And I just didn't find that very interesting. So I threw that away and then came back to it. And once I had this idea of kind of going retro with it, that led to some more story ideas that could make it a little bit more unique and hopefully be more fun to make.
You know, how involved are you in the pre-production after writing? Do you give a hand at storyboarding? Do you sort of previs things? What's that like for you?
Pre-production is incredibly important. Actually, only been lately where we have tried to go even further. So if we're going to be doing something that has a lot of CG environments, we try to nail that look and try to polish that up before filming as much as possible. You get that stuff done early, then you know how to light your scene, you know how to move the camera and the actors and all that.
That's a big thing to talk about there, green screen, matching the lighting between your pre-built worlds, especially in Evenveil, preparing those worlds before you shoot the actors. Can you just give a brief background on how that started for you guys?
Evenveil is a fantasy short that I had been thinking about for a long time that I really wanted to do. It's actually based in the same world and off some of the same characters from that college fantasy feature that I mentioned earlier. I always kind of liked that story and it stuck around with me. And I wanted to kind of revisit that world and those characters at some point. In 2020, when the pandemic got really bad, my wife and I just had our daughter. And so we were bunkered in, and I just wanted something that I could kind of work on, something creative that I could work on just for myself. And I started writing. I ended up rewriting a feature script for Evenveil. And I thought, man, it'd be really fun to just do a short version of this, or you just take a scene from the feature and do that. We knew how VFX intensive it was going to be, and it was going to take some time to complete. For that one, my biggest thing was this one prop. It's this huge double bladed axe that plays a prominent part in the story. I started looking around online, looking around on Instagram at different metalsmiths doing swords and axes and all these different kinds of weapons. And I found this one guy. His work was just exquisite, absolutely beautiful. His name's David Della Gardell. I contacted him, said, "Your work really speaks to me as someone who loves, you know, medieval armor and fantasy stuff. And any chance you could make this for us?" He said, "You know, honestly, I'm super busy right now. I don't think I can, but, you know, I'll let you know if my time opens up." A number of years prior, he had forged the sword in, I think it was a Thor movie, that Idris Elba's character carries.
Okay, yes.
So he's definitely in demand. And so I said, "Okay, no problem. I totally understand." And like an hour later, he emails me back. He said, "Are you the Sam Balcomb who did this thing back in like the early 2000s? He was talking about the fantasy feature I did in college. You know, even though it wasn't released, we still had like the website and all that stuff. But he was a fan from back in the day, just by complete coincidence." And so, "Okay, well, I totally got to work on this now." So, "Okay, well, we're definitely filming this now." So that's kind of how it started.
What was it like on Evenveil from pre-production to the end, really? And we'll go into it a bit more detail.
You know, the two big things were creating the environments and casting. So a couple of the actors actually reprised their roles from the earlier project. For designing the environments, it was around the time that I first started working with Redshift and Quixel Megascans. I'd, you know, obviously been incredibly impressed with the stuff that I'd seen made with it. So the next step after that was, after we'd created some test environments, is to put it on the green screen and see how well we could match it. I really wanted to step up my game with green screen compositing, which I have been doing for a long time, especially on client jobs. You know, we get the green screen footage from the client, and you know, we haven't even made the environment yet. So we have to make the environment match the lighting that they shot with, but DPs have such a hard job on green screen anyway. If they don't know, you know, what's the sky doing? Where are the light sources coming from? What's bouncing? How close is that wall that's going to bounce that onto them? If they don't know that, then there's only so much you can do. So we said, "Okay, well, we're in lockdown. We have all the time in the world right now. So we're just going to just keep kind of building these environments and knowing exactly where people are going to be standing." And my partner, Jesse, stood out there. We just kind of had him stand and in front of the green screen, and we ran a live HDMI feed from that to the computer where we could do a live key, have the environments up, and be able to, in semi-real time, move lighting around both virtually and physically. Obviously, that's a technique that's been done for a long time there, but it was the first time that we really tried to zero in on that realism of lighting and not making everything super perfect. Kind of similar with the Metroid thing is that I wanted things to be a little rough, a little imperfect. So, you know, if we have this environment, if we're really here, how do we light this set? You know, we didn't often do like nice beauty hair lights on people because that just it made it look too good. It looked too green screen, really. That's kind of how we approached the development of that.
I know the first time I glanced before I got into any of the behind the scenes and really did research on how it was made, and it's probably just obviously down to your guys' talent and your experience with green screen and just VFX in general and the stuff that you've done prior to it. Yeah, the quality is top quality stuff.
Thank you very much.
And what about previs for that? Do you do any previs? Is it boards? Because I know that you're, you know, planning ahead so much with environments and actors.
Since we had the environments ahead of time. There was definitely more that we could do in previs and do some animated camera moves. As far as the 3D program, we were all using Cinema 4D. Everything built in there, we just had a lot of preset camera moves, like using the C4D take system, you know, just kind of match that on the dolly or the jib or whatever we were doing to match as closely as possible. But at the same time, leave room for improvisation, because I also don't want to be completely locked in on something where we can't find something new on the set. So, oh, you know, this angle is way better, or this, you know, if we move around here, that's going to be so much better. I pretty much was open to everything changing at any point. There's a scene earlier on where our character walks into the city and she's surrounded by these guards holding swords. Originally, in the previs, the camera stayed very tight on the whole scene. I was like, okay, this should feel very claustrophobic, like she's getting hemmed in by these guards. But watching it, it was at the sacrifice of the scale of the scene, and also it was sacrificing geography. It was kind of hard to tell where everyone was. Let's throw in this very wide shot, and we can see her surrounded by everybody, see where she is in the city. We had a plate of her that worked at that angle, but we didn't have a plate of the guards from those specific angles. So I just, you know, threw the costume on Jesse. We went in front of the green screen here, comped him in, and it ended up working out really well. Pre-production, previs, filming, and post all kind of mashed together.
Yeah, I was going to say, it sounds like it's kind of circulating, you know, shoot something, need something else, go and shoot it, bring it back in.
And I love that. It's great. It makes it feel, it's almost like you're working in like an animated film in that sense, where you can just, okay, let's just go back and try something new. Let's do it and fabricate an entirely new shot. I love that freedom.
I mean, I was shocked, because it seems a very limiting space, but the scale and the quality of the final thing is something that you would imagine that is shot on a much bigger scale in terms of space. I mean, I don't know if it was just me, but things like the new Thor movie, Love and Thunder, there was something about those shots with, you know, on the green screen, things felt not tangible and like unrealistic and didn't feel great.
God, that hurts.
And when you look at what you guys have done here in such a small space, it's incredible. What was it like working in that space?
That was something that we were very, very much aware of, and that was a huge goal going into this, was like, how do we create that sense of scale with the small space that we have? If we can pull a few grand out that would have spent going to a big stage, let's do that. It comes down to me to the planning of the storyboards. Sketch the boards with, you know, limitless potential. It's like, okay, What's the craziest epic shot that I can think of? What kind of framing, what kind of camera move? And not worry about how. I'm not going to worry about how to do it. Our poor actors were always, we're spinning them around so much, because we only had maybe 90 degrees worth, I think, of green screen, maybe less than that. So, you know, anytime we needed to get, okay, we're gonna dolly up on you from this side looking at this, and then you're going to turn around, we're going to get the reverse, but we can't get the reverse because there's no green back there.
Yeah, so we need to turn you around.
Your eye line is now over here. They did amazingly, even though like all the three young actors in it who we worked with for the first time, this is their first time working on a green screen. I actually haven't seen the last Thor movie, so I can't speak to that. But I know that from what I heard, I think they shot a lot of it on the volume. There's productions that use the volume incredibly well, where you would never, ever know. I haven't shot on the volume. I was just over on one the other day. Actually, the guys who did our mocap on Metroid opened up a volume stage not too far from here, so I went to check it out. I definitely want to try it. It would be fun to do. Yeah, I would want to keep in mind where it's not just something you just kind of go in and, okay, well, let's try these angles and this, because there's still only, like, you're still pretty limited to the camera moves you can do on that.
Definitely.
And you can't do these big things where you'll come up, sweep down, and look up to the sky there.
The scale of the volume, if you're working on like a small projector, or you've got an LED wall, or you're shooting into a corner, even though you can change the world and, you know, scale it up, you're still limited to where the camera can go. Because as soon as you go off the volume, it's not like a green screen where you can kind of roto out and you can expand the world and track it. Unless I'm wrong there.
You can. The cameras that you're filming on have motion trackers on them, where and then LiDAR and all that. So in the computer, you're still tracking what the camera is doing. So you can bring that data in to post and extend that shot past the screens if you want to. The other thing, too, to keep in mind is that there's still a ton of post work that has to be done on those shots.
Yes, definitely.
a lot more than a lot of people realize. Sometimes the backgrounds are replaced entirely in post anyway. There's a technique that some of them do where they actually shoot every other frame. They shoot at a higher frame, like 48, and every other frame is actually capturing a green screen, or the wall is flashing green.
Ah, okay.
So that way you have the option, okay, well, we have the pass with the volume behind it, and then you also have a pass with green behind it.
That's interesting.
But yeah, there's a lot of cleanup that needs to happen. If the camera's a little bit too close and the screen is completely in focus, sometimes you see the LEDs, sometimes you see that little pattern. So you have to fix that. We're still kind of in the honeymoon phase right now of the technology, but it'll get better, and the filmmakers will get more used to it.
Yeah, and I guess it'll go from, you know, virtual production and this to just the word production. That's just the new way of doing things.
Which I think it's also really important for directors to be extremely educated in these tools. There's been some problems on some bigger shoots where the director doesn't really understand the VFX pipeline. They don't really quite understand how it all works. So they're maybe asking for things that are a little bit too difficult or that are going to add a lot of time in post. These decisions are going to make things way more complicated and cost a lot more money. You know, it's not the director's job to know all the nuts and bolts of how all this stuff works. I think having experience in that, I think, helps everybody. I was in Boston and I came back here and got my degree at Art Center College of Design in Pasadena. I loved the film program there because it was super hands-on. And one of the, I guess it was the unspoken rule of the film program was that if you're on set and, you know, someone drops dead, you should be able to walk over there and do their job.
Shit.
Essentially meaning that, you know, you should kind of know how to do all this stuff as much as you can, because one, if you get out of school and you can't get work directing or doing that thing that you want, you've got all these backup skills. But also, you know, and also you may find that you love doing one of those jobs more than this other thing. Also, it helps you speak to those people better. Like if you understand a gaffer's job or a dolly grip, if you really understand what they're doing, you can talk to them a lot better and production will go faster. And I think that's the same way with visual effects.
As a director, so on projects like this, what's it like for you to get that work-life balance? Is it easy to switch off?
It's gotten a lot easier over time. When we started Rainfall, we were all working just out of our respective homes. And, you know, there was no separation between work life and home life. I was in my 20s when Rainfall started. So, like, I was devil may care. Like, hell yeah, I'll pull an all-nighter.
Yeah.
Let's do it. But yeah, as I got older and as the company went on, it started to be a much more of a burden, especially when you're working on some higher stress projects for clients and things where you don't want to bring that home with you. You don't want to have that around the dinner table. But that was around the time where we said, okay, you know what, guys, I think we really need to get like a physical office space just to have that be somewhere else, somewhere other than
separate it.
And once we did that, once we went to an office, I found my stress level went way down. I felt so much better being able to leave that behind and come home and have a nice dinner and watch a movie and just kind of chill out.
What kind of things do you do to unwind, just out of interest?
My daughter just turned 3 years old, so weekends is just kind of about finding fun things to do together, do things that spark her imagination because she's a super creative kid. Yeah, otherwise unwinding. My wife and I, we love watching movies and shows. We love video games. Actually, when we first met, we were heavily playing World of Warcraft, so we would play that together all the time. Between all those things, there's no other hours left in the day.
What's it like watching video game cinematics as a director and writer? Do you tear them apart, or do you just try and switch off that part of your brain?
I mean, I'm super into how video games are made and development, and I have a lot of friends in that area. I just kind of like seeing what different games do, especially with cinematics. I think within our first year, sometime after that Zelda trailer came out, we were contacted by BioWare, because they were in development on the first Dragon Age game. They were actually looking at the option of doing the cinematics as live action. It was cool and all that, but I think we all agreed that it would just be too weird jumping to a live action cutscene and then back to the game. It would feel kind of dated in the way that, you know, it's like a full motion video CD-ROM games or something. You know, we've gotten to the point now, of course, where game engine graphics are just so damn good, there's no need to do anything, you know, live action for them. I'm a big fan of the recent God of War games, that idea of keeping one continuous camera movement, so you're not cutting away from the action. You're not cutting away from the controls too much and still getting a cinematic story.
Have you seen the Raising Kratos documentary?
I have, yes. Yeah, my friend Bear did the music for those games.
Oh, really? Amazing.
Incredible the amount of work that went into them. And I'm so happy to see them turn out well and also be so well received.
Yeah, big time, big time. If we can end on one great piece of advice that you've ever been given or you can give out to anybody getting into writing, directing.
Yeah, if you're not having fun, find something else to do. As stressful and heartbreaking and difficult as this job is, I still have fun doing it. Recently, one of my favorite bits of advice that I've heard is your creativity is not endless. It requires fuel. And you can run out of that fuel. And I was kind of feeling that way about a year or so ago, where I had these projects that were really fun. I wanted to do them, but once I got to the computer, or I got to the planning stage, or even the piece of paper, I just had no motivation to keep going. I realized that my fuel tanks were empty. You know, for me, it's like the answer to that is just to watch more movies, play more games, read more books, get inspired by what other people are doing.
That's a great piece of advice. Sam, it's been an absolute pleasure chatting with you today, so thank you.
Well, thank you. Thanks for having me on. This is great. It's always fun to chat about the process and all that, and I appreciate all the kind words.
Brilliant, man. We love it. Thanks, Sam. And we'll speak to you soon, man. We'll catch up.
Sounds great.
Okay, brilliant, Sam. Take care, man.
Adios.